See his palette, his brushes, and one work that's currently on his easel. So Bill, let's first start with that beautiful array of brushes over there. Do you have any favorites that you tend to use over other ones?
This is the one I like for small detail work. But I don't know, other than that, their brushes are brushes, and I just go through and pick out one that is I feel is appropriate, but I don't know. I don't have any favorites or.
So you don't have any brushes with a name that you've given?
No.
And you don't file them down or customize them?
No.
So just brushes.
If they aren't what I want, I throw them away and buy a new one.
Throw away brushes. That's not a common thing artists do. So Bill, this palette over here, is this one that you've had for a while?
And this?
Is this your typical color selection?
I've had that for a long time. I scrape it off from time to time and then start over with some new colors.
Let's take a look at the painting that's on your easel. It's a cowboy on a horse, penciled, and then it's got the brown wash on it. Is this typical how you would start a painting?
Yeah, I usually... Usually I'll pencil it in or charcoal it in, and then I put a wash on top. I want to get something on there so that, you know, it doesn't scare you. Because an empty canvas is very scary. This way it's already ruined. I mean, I've already got stuff painted on it. And I usually go with a medium tone so that I can kind of work both directions.
So that tone will eventually show through in the finished painting?
Yes, some of it will, some of it won't. Some of it might be totally covered. But it allows me, when it's a medium tone, it allows me to go both directions quickly.
Okay.
And I paint a little lighter tone. It's lighter on here because I've already got this wash in the back. Or darker, as the case with a black face or dark face.
How much redrawing happens through the process of a painting?
It depends on how lucky you are. You know, if you get a good lick, it comes pretty fast. Otherwise, you know, you labor over it, and then you repaint it, and then you paint out, and then redraw, and it just, and you never know. And there's no particular subject matter that tells you this is going to be a hard one, or this is, you just... have to wait till it happens, and then.
Is there a point in your painting when it, this is going to work, this is it, everything's come together?
When I start one, and then I'm hoping I'm right. I think there is. I think when you, at least the way I paint, I'll use this and I'll cover the whole thing with a tone of some sort. Then I start working in darks and lights, and you reach a point where you can begin to see whether it's going to work or not. I can't tell you when that is because it varies. So it isn't a formula. It isn't, you know, A, B, C, D.
paint by numbers is that. You fill in the little colors. This isn't. It's trial and error.
Return to the thrilling days of yesteryear. Cougar, an award-winning short action movie created by, written by, directed by, and starring Bill Moomey.
Speaking. Well, thank goodness I got a hold of you. Another lion killing this morning. Hey, Bill, I sure would appreciate it if you could come up and track down that cuss before he cleans me out.
Sure, we'll be up in the morning.
Okay.
One thing you know for sure about a lion, he'll hit for the rocks if he can. Oh, he'll take his time first. Double back over in his own tracks a couple times just to throw the dogs off. And then he'll crawl into the roughest country he can find. His tracks keep getting warmer by the minute. And a howler lets you know it, too. There it is! That's the sound you've been waiting for. He jumped him. Ain't no time for fooling around now. You gotta go and you gotta go hard so you don't lose sound of your hound dogs. You don't feel good for them to put them up a tree if you don't know where they are. Lion can't run too far after he's been jumped like a bear can. Oh, he can go a good many miles at his own pace. When he's pushed, it don't take long to wear him out. Anyhow, takes a heap of running for anything to outlast a hungry hound dog. Just about one thing left for old Tom to do is to climb up on the highest rock he can find and fight it out when they catch up to him. They catch up to him, all right. And they fight it out. This chap figures his best bet is somewhere in the top of an old spruce tree looking down. And it's a mighty good thing, too. After chasing him halfway across the country, you feel as though you kind of know him. Yeah, well, maybe you ought to try to catch him, lock him up, till you get your rope and you start up after him. Ain't no tomfoolery at this point. He just as leave get you by the throat and look at you. You watch yourself, boy. Yeah, I'll play with him. I'll push him. No easy. Just keep your mind on that rope and then throw it. Hey, play careful. Hey, grab him quick. Watch your old jaws can snap your arm right in two if he ever got a hold of you. Bite anything now. I can't think of anything safer than letting him take his bite out on a pine stick. Besides, he'll give you something to tie to. You can just keep his mouth shut. You hoist him up on your horse. Providing you got the kind of horse that's still around after waving that lion under his nose. And you start crawling down off that mountain. Oh, you're tired. Yeah, but you feel good that you didn't have to shoot him.
Bill was born in 1925 in York, Nebraska. He lost his mother to tuberculosis when he was four. His father, Lynn,
remarried when Bill was six, and his stepmother provided love and encouragement, all he could ask for. It was in these years that his dual interest of art and Western horsemanship evolved. You started drawing things. And you don't know why, but you just started drawing things.
Oh, I do know why. Of course I know why. Because the pencil was my folks' babysitter. You know, they kept me out of the way and out of trouble. They'd stick me over the corner and give me a little pad and a pencil, and I was good for the rest of the afternoon.
Yeah. So as you were growing up on your dad Lynn's ranch, and he was doing cattle, it was like a real working ranch.
Oh yeah. Well, that's the way he made his living in meat. You know, that's all I remember of my dad. He was always working. You know, I don't think my dad ever had any fun. Because everything I remember about him, he was busy working and making a living, as we say. So, but I love my dad. He was, he just was a very special guy. As I said earlier, he had no education. He went to high school, but you could ask him anything about anything, and he would know the answer. I don't know how he got it or where he got it, but he seemed to know everything about everything. And I was always impressed with him as a kid. Well, that's why I wrote this Dad Always Said stuff, because boy, everything that came out of his mouth was wow. The very last paragraph of the book says, "Did your dad really say all those things that you've written about in the book?" The answer is probably.
it's priceless. Highly, highly recommended. So Bill, as a 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 year old, you were then out helping, getting up the cows, and this is a meat operation, not a dairy operation.
Yes, right.
So you were exposed to Western lifestyle from the worker perspective early.
Oh yeah. I was not only exposed to it, I was forced into it. You know, that's what you did. You had to earn your keep. And you had certain jobs, depending on your age and your size and everything. And when you were little, you took care of the chickens. And then as you grew up, you advanced to more difficult tasks. But that was a good life. I had a great life when I look back.
And then as an early teenager, a man came to town who's the brother of a woman who lives there. And he's come to York as a very successful Northeastern artist for health reasons. And he takes you in.
Yeah, for health reasons. He was a drunk. He had a drinking problem. And he couldn't take care of himself. So he moved back to Nebraska, and he was a very well-known New York illustrator, and a very good one. When he was sober, I mean, he was really good. When he was drunk, he was good, but it was a shame, because he was such a great guy that just the booze got a hold of him, and you know, and he had to have somebody to take care of him. But it was fortunate for me, because in New York, Nebraska, we didn't have people like that. So you had no role model, you had no help at all. So I was very lucky at somebody else's expense.
So in exchange for cleaning his studio, he gave you basic art lessons.
Yeah. You mix, like I say, you mix green with, if you want to kill red a little bit, but you still want it red, you put a little green with it.
Who'd ever think of that? Well, that doesn't even logical, but it works. And yeah, he taught me all of those, what we look at now as basic. They weren't basic then. They were like, wow. And I was just very fortunate. My whole life has been a series of lucky things. I don't think I've ever earned anything. I just fell into most of my life. It's been just a lucky accident. I just didn't realize, I guess, until later that you made money doing it. And that was a nice surprise.
And now as a young teenager, you've got more important things to do on the ranch, like breaking horses.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, they put me on as a kid because, you know, when you're a kid, first of all, you don't break bones and all that stuff. And you're lightweight, and you're disposable. You know, something happens to you, they have another kid. I had a great life, just an absolutely great life.
And so you were like the neighborhood horse breaking guy for 10 years.
Yeah.
And people would bring their horses over.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you'd have to break a horse before breakfast?
Yeah, because these guys, you know, they were usually older guys. They didn't want to get on one of those horses, get hurt. But a young kid, you know, they didn't care if I got hurt because I would mend. And, I had a nice little side job breaking horses for people.
And at the same time, then you started going into rodeo and were in the bucking bronco part of the rodeo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I rode bucking horses.
Any ribbons?
Oh, we didn't get ribbons for that. You got money for it. And I've got a lot of, as I say, I made a movie on the history of rodeo.
So while you're doing the rodeo and the horse breaking for all your neighbors, you're still drawing. So you're getting real firsthand experience about the details of this part of Western life.
Yeah, yeah.
Bill was an all-around great athlete. In high school, Bill was a star running back in football, led his basketball team to the state championship, and never lost a track race. After World War II, he was a star football and track athlete at the University of Nebraska, tying the world record in the 60-yard low hurdles. He was an Olympic silver medalist in field archery and was selected as York High School Athlete of the Century. Oh, by the way, and if this isn't enough, he was also the lead singer for the Clyde McCoy Big Band.
Like many American boys, Bill graduated from high school and immediately joined the service, the Navy. At 17, he became the pilot of a TBF torpedo bomber. Commanding a crew of three, he flew carrier operations in 1945. This now you're in high school and your athletic career takes off in high school, but World War II was happening. Mm-hmm. How did that affect you and as you graduated from high school?
Oh, well, it affected me like it affected all young kids. You know, when you graduated, you went right into the service. I mean, you were drafted into something rather than be drafted, because I joined the Naval Air Corps.
And so Billy went down to Pensacola for pilot training.
Yes.
And eventually got assigned to a torpedo bomb.
Mm-hmm. TBF.
A TBF. Mm-hmm. And there was a three-man crew.
Correct. We had a turret right behind my seat. I was in the driver's seat. There was a turret right behind me with twin 50 caliber machine guns. And it swiveled, the turret swiveled, so that you could shoot planes that were coming in on you. And down below was a radio man, and he had twin 30 calibers down there so that he could shoot something that was coming up from underneath.
And 30 caliber wouldn't do much damage.
It's a deer rifle.
Yeah, okay.
You know, kind of the equivalent.
So you were 17 or 18 at this time?
17.
17, and you're in charge of your own torpedo bomber, two other guys depending upon you, and you got to practice carrier landings in Pensacola. How did that go?
Well, I was just lucky I was 17, because you have no fear. But I'd hate to do it today and learn. I mean, once you do it a while, it's like anything else. You learn how to land when the ship is coming up like this instead of when it's down. But no, as I say, 17-year-olds they don't think. They just do it. Everything is fun. You know, I don't know if it'd be fun today.
Probably not.
But it was fun then.
So you had a story about navigating. Because you're in charge of all the navigation and flying the airplane. You had a lot of responsibilities as a pilot.
Yeah, it wasn't like it is today where you've got navigators and computers and it does all that for you. And the scary part was, because I was flying off of a carrier, and so you didn't have computers, you had a lap board, and you kept track of it with a pencil. You kept your course. So if you knew how fast you were going and what direction you were going, you drew a little line down there so you always knew where you were. But then you also had to consider where the ship was, where your carrier was. Because you didn't want to be out there here and have him going over there and you didn't know where he was. So that's not fun.
How many hours of fuel did you have?
Well, we flew four hours.
So you couldn't make very many mistakes in your navigation.
No, not over the ocean.
So when you were riding on the board, did you put your plane in autopilot?
No, flew with the other hand. You know, it's funny. Today, I've got a couple of friends who were ex-pilots. One of them was a test pilot, in fact, and you know, he flew. I said, you know, because we talk about this sometimes, and I'd never flown a jet, so I wouldn't have any idea what it was like. But I said, the difference is, when you were going straight up in the air, with the earth just disappearing behind you, I was down below trying to get my engine started.
because, you know, you're doing this. And, well, you know, whenever I talk like this, my son said, "Dad, you sound like an old man." I said, "I'm 95 years old." "Well, what do you consider an old man?" "Of course I'm an old man."
So this particular airplane just had one speed.
Like I said, it took off at 90, flew at 90, and landed at 90.
And so on your torpedo run into whatever the target ship was, how many feet off the water were you?
Well, you had one torpedo on the belly of your plane, plus your wing guns. So you had one shot at something. I don't think anybody ever took a ship down with a torpedo. Whoever invented it really kind of might have been okay on paper, but when you dropped your torpedo and the ship is here and you're dropping it here, you've got to consider how fast he's going so that your torpedo doesn't go behind him and all. But the problem with it, that I'm sure nobody thought of when they designed that torpedo, if it doesn't just land perfectly flat in the water where it can go ahead, if it's slightly nose down, it just goes choom. You know, it doesn't go anywhere. You've shot your torpedo, it's about 10 feet.
So you were, the war's over, you've been recruited to go play football by a famous Nebraska football coach during the war, and now you go to Nebraska and resume your art career as an art major and playing football at the University of Nebraska. Professional life and the path back to the West, or how Bill met Coy's Bonanza. Bill graduated from Nebraska and taught at the University of Colorado. He led the Denver Art Academy. His experience with administration convinced him to become a full-time practicing artist. This ambition was realized in 1955 when he created the BMF Art and Design Studio, Designs That Sell. He developed a number of iconic products. So, Bill, you went through the years at Nebraska. You had an incredibly successful football career there, and you got a very solid art education. And at the point in time you're going to graduate, you were presented with two options, two roads to lead your life by. Tell us about those two options.
Well, the two options turned out to be not too difficult to decide, because one, I had a chance to go play professional football for the New York Giants at a pretty good salary, or I had a teaching job at the University of Colorado for not quite as much, but wasn't that much difference in money. But that wasn't the thing that made me decide. I just decided that my days of playing football and all were, it was fun while it lasted, but I'm not going to do that anymore.
So you get to Colorado, you pursue your MFA in art at Colorado, graduate, become director of the Denver Academy of Art.
Yeah.
From University of Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
And so for a number of years, you're the teacher creating the curriculum and teaching students about art.
Yeah. But it was a part that I didn't really enjoy that much, because it was more administrative. And I did it because I was the boss, but it wasn't just what I enjoyed doing.
So Bill, you're in Milwaukee working in the liquor industry, and you've got a lot of creative breadth in the things that you can go do. What are some of the interesting projects you got to work on in that job?
That's where I came up with Paint My Numbers, because a lot of people want to paint, think they are painting, if they fill in number four is red, number six is green, and so that's where I came up with that.
But all this time, of course, you're still doing painting as your second full-time job.
Yeah, yeah.
So you get back to Colorado, and this is where the horse breeding, the quarter horse story, kind of fits in nicely.
Well, I had horses ever since I was a little kid. You know, like I said, my dad was in the cattle business, and so we had horses. They were using horses, that we used to call them, because you used them. They weren't just fun horses. They weren't just pleasure horses. You used your horses. People began to hear about my skills in breaking horses and getting them to do what you want them to do. And so I started getting people that were bringing their horses over for me to train.
And so you happened into a championship quarter horse that's now in the Quarter Horse Hall of Fame.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he's sired more champions than any other horse in history. He was, I came across the horse, a guy up in Wyoming had this horse, and he didn't know what to do with it, because he didn't want to stand him a stud, and he didn't want to do this, but he was a fantastic horse. So he called me and said, you know, I know you are into horses and so forth, and I have this horse that I don't know what to do with. So could you help me move him? And so when I got up there and looked at the horse and found out a little bit more about him, I said, yeah, I can move him. I can move him right into my stall, which I did. And we had 6 world champions by that stud. And he became probably the top quarter horse ever, you know, as far as him siring top horses and him and his personal achievements. So I was lucky to have found a horse like that.
So I have one more question. Yeah. What was the name of the horse?
Coy's Bonanza.
But your authenticity in having been a cowboy, sketching horses and cowboys and cattle, breeding and raising horses of championship caliber, you've done all your life. So when you draw a cowboy, you draw a cow, you draw a horse, you're drawing it from first person knowledge.
Oh yeah, yeah. I know what they look like when they turn. For example, you know, you don't have a horse turn like this with his head like this. Well, that's just because you've been on one when it's turned.
I wrestled them two old bears to the ground. A painting explained. Bill, you had said in one of your books that you thought the cowboys were as good a storyteller as anybody that ever lived. And we want to talk about this painting down to your left, where we've got a cowboy perhaps telling a story to a young admirer.
Well, I think you can see from the kid's expression that he's just awed by this lie that he's telling his kid. Because he's probably telling his kid he did all these wonderful things that he never did, but he's sucking it all in. You know, he's intrigued. And I forget the name of this. And then I wrestled them two old bears to the ground, maybe.
Well, that would certainly be a great title for this.
Yeah.
If we look at some of the details, we've got the Indian saddle blanket under the young man's saddle. His short, looks like Wellington boots, the bolo tie around the neckerchief, the beautiful patina on the leather chaps of the cowboy, the cowboy hat style, all these things just seem so authentic.
Bill and Sandy had a friend in Tucson and decided to move here to live in Vail. Bill's art career continued to flourish with solo shows at the Ameren Museum in 2015 and at the Medeiros Gallery in 2016. Bill was selected as a Mountain Oyster Club artist in 2005 and FWA Artist of the Year in 2015. Bill is rightly portrayed in the famous painting, The Masters, which is prominently displayed in the Mountain Oyster Club.
And Bill, one last brief question. How did you and Sandy come to Tucson?
We had friends here who owned a couple of houses here, and then they owned this place and said, we've got just a spot for you, kind of thing. So we came out and
Bill, thanks so much. It's been a long afternoon. This artist journey has been special. You're a special guy, and we're just so fortunate to have you in our community.
Thank you. This is the one I like for small detail work.